friends with.
Touch me in the pouring rain, and the moment that you wander far from me, I wanna feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love and your softly. And it's me you need to share. How deep is your love?
One of the requirements for producing a quality brew is to allow enough time for the lager to mature properly. There is, however, a particular lager that's allowed to mature for an even longer period. The consequence of this is that when it is fully matured, it's a little stronger than most other lagers. So remember, gently does it.
A lovely day turns out so well. Hazelnuts and caramel, dairy boxes, milk chocolates, round trees making whoopee.
Country roads take me home to the place I belong.
There's a wimpy super warm home waiting for you, and we can offer you a 100% mortgage.
Take me home, country road.
A home with super warm insulation and smaller heating bills.
Take me home to the place I belong. Take me home.
Wimpy. Welcome home.
There, there, there. New Elastoplast antiseptic liquid.
Ow!
There, there, there. Soothing Elastoplast antiseptic cream.
Quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, oh!
There, there, there. More care and protection from Elastoplast.
The Pentax ME Super. An automatic SLR camera with a manual override that enables you to change shutter speed at the press of a button without taking your eye off the subject. this a thing. Pentax, don't be seen with anything less.
How far across the channel will £4 to £6 get this family and car at peak time this summer? Ferry A will get them almost three quarters of the way, Ferry B no further, and Ferry C, well, perhaps they could swim the rest. With Sally the Viking Line, £46 gets them all the way to France. Check our peak time family fares against anyone else's. You'll find Sally's are the cheapest. See your travel agent or ring 01200 0200.
This is the Braun Micron Deluxe, and I'm Ian Botham. There's a fantastic £5 refund on these Micron shavers, a £3 refund on Synchron, £2 on Braun battery shavers, and a £3 refund on the Lady Elegance, the Lady Shaver. How's that for a shave? And how's that for a price?
Now is the time to protect and support your plants with Netlon. Netlon, for better net results.
Right after the news tonight, part two of the South Bank Show special on the life of the composer Stravinsky. But now it's time for us to go over to the studios of ITN for the latest international news, read by Alastair Stewart.
Argentine president tells his people, let the British come, we'll fight them. Common market bans Argentine imports, they lose their biggest customer. Liverpool surge ahead, but QPR take a tumble. And the Transglobe expedition is just 5 miles from the North Pole. Good evening. Despite the transatlantic diplomacy of the American Secretary of State, Mr. Haig, the Argentine president has repeated his warning to Britain that he's prepared to go to war over the Falklands. President Galtieri was speaking immediately after his first round of talks with Mr. Haig. They'll be meeting again in a few minutes' time. Speaking to a crowd of more than 200,000 people in Buenos Aires, he urged Britain to use restraint. But referring to the task force now heading for the South Atlantic, he said, if they want to come, let them come. We'll do battle. In Barbados, President Reagan, who's on holiday, went on radio to pledge that the United States would do everything they could to resolve the dispute without bloodshed. In Buenos Aires, demonstrations have been going on all day.
In scenes reminiscent of the Peronist days of nationalist fervor, the crowd swelled the Plaza de Mayo around the presidential palace to express support for their government. The prospect of Britain's naval blockade of the Falklands on Monday does not appear to worry the Argentine people, and the reality of the violence that could follow seemed far away as they celebrated their occupation of the islands. Mr. Haig's car was almost overwhelmed as he arrived to open his talks with the Argentine leader. The Secretary of State was bringing an uncompromising message from Britain, and both sides acknowledged that negotiating a settlement will be extremely difficult. The meeting with President Galtieri lasted for more than an hour, during which Argentina is believed to have strongly asserted its rights to the Falkland Islands. Mr. Haig finally left by helicopter because of the crowds who choked the streets around the presidential palace. The demonstrations continued throughout the afternoon and finally drew President Galtieri to the balcony, where he declared that Argentina was ready to do battle with anyone who touched a single piece of Argentine territory.
Con voluntad decidida como el pueblo argentino, si quieren venir, que vengan, les presentaremos batalla.
The Argentine government had asked for a display of solidarity from its people today, and it got one in full measure. The diplomatic dialogue between Secretary of State Haig and President Galtieri was tough, and the message from the crowd summed it up. Argentina will not give up the Falkland Islands without a fight. Norman Rees, ITN, in Buenos Aires.
The common market has banned all imports from Argentina. EEC ambassadors agreed on the trade embargo at a special meeting in Brussels. Our diplomatic editor, Michael Brunson, assesses the effects of the ban.
However buoyed up he may have been by today's huge demonstration, General Galtieri knows that the common market has dealt him a serious blow cutting off his biggest single overseas market and a quarter of his entire exports. Tonight, the junta described Europe's action as an act of violent economic aggression and strongly hinted that it will retaliate, presumably by cutting off Europe's exports to Argentina. Most of Argentina's exports to Europe have been agricultural products. And while Argentina has been doing very nicely recently with its huge grain sales to Russia and has a steady market in Latin America, the country has now lost £1,000 million worth a year of foreign exchange. Europe, which runs a trade surplus with Argentina, will lose something too, since exports to Argentina will almost certainly now be affected, which makes today's decision even more remarkable. For this crisis has done what Poland and Afghanistan could not. It's produced the fastest, toughest, and most united reaction the common market has ever agreed to. It significantly increases the international pressure on Argentina and strengthens Britain's diplomatic hand. No wonder the Foreign Office says it's very, very pleased.
The Ministry of Defence say the Royal Navy task force is on course and on time as it heads south for the Falklands. Here, the Engineering Workers' Union lifted an overtime ban, which was threatening to hold up replacement engines for the fleet's Sea Harriers. Poland has ordered its fishing fleet out of the 200-mile war zone, and Argentina is reported to have been laying mines around the Falklands. The main part of the task force is now in its sixth day at sea. The liner Canberra, requisitioned to take 2,000 troops, is one day out of Southampton.
With England barely out of sight, the 2,000 men soon found out this was to be no cruise. The Royal Marines and paratroopers are proud of their fitness, and during the next few weeks, they're not going to be allowed to lose it.
All right, two there!
The promenade deck of Canberra had never seen passengers take their exercise like this before. Weapons drill, too, is a regular activity. These men are going through their paces with a self-loading rifle, the infantryman's standard weapon.
And carry on firing.
Some of the many other types of guns were brought on deck and given an airing. This is fairly basic training, but one of the problems during our journey south is going to be keeping the men occupied and fully prepared for whatever they may be facing. These paratroopers are brushing up with anti-tank rocket launchers. Keeping close company with Canberra is the Elk, another P&O vessel, with her armoured vehicles on board, there to be used by other units with us on board Canberra. The fleet auxiliary Plumleaf is with us too, and Canberra has become the first ever British cruise liner able to take on fuel at sea. The helicopter support ship Engadine has been marking our progress from a distance. And so routine aboard Canberra has been established as hectic but useful. And morale among the men is, if anything, higher now than it was when we were cheered out of Southampton. Jeremy Hands, British Television News, aboard Canberra.
And we've learnt in the last few minutes that a Russian ship has begun shadowing the Canberra. It's reported to be only 2 miles away. Thousands of anti-nuclear demonstrators marched in Scotland and the southwest today. In Glasgow, over 10,000 demonstrated against the government's Trident nuclear missile programme. It was one of the largest demonstrations ever seen in Scotland. The organisers said they would picket the entrance to any Trident bases set up in Scotland. In Plymouth, only about 2,000 demonstrators turned out, less than half the number organisers expected. They said the Falkland Islands crisis had reduced the number of marchers. The jury in the Terry May murder trial at the Old Bailey are being given a day off tomorrow, an Easter Day coach trip to the country, though they've been told they mustn't mix with any outsiders. The jury told the judge in a note today that they were tired after 5 days of trying to decide verdicts. That makes it the longest retirement ever at the Old Bailey. The jury returned one not guilty verdict today, their first, on a charge of riot against one of the 11 defendants. He's still charged with another man with the murder of Terry May, a physically handicapped youth killed in South London last summer. The United States has sent a message to the Israelis calling for the utmost restraint following reports they are prepared to invade southern Lebanon. The Lebanese president, Elias Sarkis, says the Israelis have amassed 40,000 troops on his southern border. He's appealed to the Americans and the Russians to intervene. The Israeli Prime Minister, Mr. Begin, has refused to confirm or deny reports that he plans to take advantage of the preoccupation with the Falklands crisis to invade. Now, on a day when Liverpool stretched their lead at the top of the first division and one of the cup finalists took a knock, here's our sports correspondent, Ian Edwards.
The almost irresistible force that is Liverpool is heading towards yet another league championship. Today's 5-0 thrashing of Manchester City at Main Road now makes it 7 wins in a row for them and puts them 5 points ahead of Ipswich. The 5 teams closest to them all failed to win, and Ipswich were beaten by Glenn Hoddle, whose goal kept FA Cup finalists Tottenham in with an outside chance of league honours. Luton's draw at Cambridge increased their lead over Watford in the second division to 4 points, and while Garrick Bannister's winning goal improved Sheffield Wednesday's chances of promotion at Shrewsbury, there was a setback to Queen's Park Rangers' hopes of adding a first division place to their achievement of reaching the FA Cup final. Rangers, though, went into a deserved lead just before half-time, when Tony Curry's pass to Gregory sliced the Chelsea defence in two. Curry then showed how dangerous he could be for Rangers in next month's cup final. But though Rangers had dominated till then, in the second half they allowed Chelsea to equalise through a pile driver from Mickey Droy. Droy was in the thick of it again to lay on the winning goal for Colin Lee. It left Rangers wondering how they let victory slip away. In Scotland, Celtic overcame the other Rangers 2-1 to stay on course for another Premier League title. The champions are now 7 points ahead of Aberdeen, who beat Hibernian 3-0. The top 2 seeds meet tomorrow in the finals of the first major outdoor tennis event of the season, the Monte Carlo Grand Prix. Today, the number 1 seed, Ivan Lendl of Czechoslovakia, beat Yannick Noah of France. The commentator, Bill Threlfall.
Great play. Very, very good play by both players in stages throughout this match. Very, very interesting match, I thought that.
In the other semi-final, Guillermo Vilas beat his fellow Argentine José Luis Clerc, but it took him nearly 3 hours to do it. Britain's Peter Oosterhuis is within reach of one of his best finishes on the American golf circuit as the third round of the US Masters gets underway in Augusta. He shares fourth place, only 3 strokes behind Craig Stadler and Curtis Strange, the two comparative youngsters who've taken the lead from Jack Nicklaus. Stadler came from behind in the second round. He birdied 4 out of 5 holes along the way to the 18th and had little trouble with this par-saving 6-footer despite the pressure. Strange did well too, on greens that are as slick as a mirror. As he put it, you go from being the worst player in the world to leading the Masters. And although this one went astray, it wasn't all downhill, and both he and Stadler started today's round on 144.
Our sports correspondent Ian Edwards. Finally, the two men on the British Transglobe expedition are still 5 miles from the North Pole, which they'd expected to reach earlier this evening. It's thought Sir Ranulph Fiennes and Dr. Charles Burton ran out of fuel for the snowmobiles, which have carried them most of the way over the Arctic ice cap. They had to wait more than 10 hours for a support plane to land with fresh supplies. They're now on the move again, hoping to reach the pole early tomorrow morning, which hopefully will be one of the stories we can bring you when we're back again tomorrow at midday. Join us then. Till then, good night from me.
The Falklands crisis will be examined in a special edition of Weekend World tomorrow at noon. Britain's nuclear submarines are preparing to enforce a blockade of the islands from dawn on Monday. But the new Foreign Secretary, Mr. Francis Pym, has been trying to see if negotiations can start. So what are the chances that war can still be averted? Mr. Pym will be interviewed live on Weekend World tomorrow at noon.
And now the weather for the London Weekend Television area. It will become dry overnight with clear periods. Temperatures will fall quite sharply to around 2 degrees centigrade, 36 Fahrenheit, with a fairly widespread ground frost by dawn. Tomorrow will be brighter than today with sunny periods in the morning but a few showers in the afternoon. It will be another chilly day with temperatures of 10 degrees centigrade, 50 Fahrenheit, and a light to moderate northwesterly breeze. And the outlook becoming a little warmer with some sunshine and a few showers too.
Duracell is no ordinary battery. Proof? We put Duracell into one toy, ordinary zinc carbon batteries into the others. After a few hours, the ordinary batteries are played out. But Duracell keeps going strong in this continuous test lasting six times longer. Duracell. With a copper-coloured top. No ordinary battery looks like it or lasts like it.
Some places close just when you need them most. But a NatWest service till is always open. Open 24 hours a day. Open 7 days a week. Wherever there's a NatWest service till, you can order checkbooks, order statements and draw money out of your current account. Anytime. Ask NatWest about their 24-hour service till for an easier way of life.
Air Canada announced the arrival of flight 851 from London.
Air Canada's good old Canadian hospitality makes flights so good, you won't want to get off.
This is a truly extraordinary lager. Tennent's Extra. Brewed that extra bit longer. For extra flavor. Extra strength and extra taste. Tennent's Extra, the extraordinary lager.
There's a great paint. And behind Berger's non-drip Magic Coat, there's now a great offer. The special price of Magic Coat Brilliant White Emulsion at Art Wallpapers. £3.49 for 2.5 litres. Magic Coat, the paint that makes it easier.
Hello. Last night we showed part one of what attempts to be a comprehensive biography of one of the greatest composers of the 20th century, Igor Stravinsky. Part one dealt with his Russian years, his childhood, the sources of his ideas, his early training, and his first successes with Diaghilev and Nijinsky. Tonight we follow Stravinsky through the rest of his life, which encompasses many years in Europe, mostly in France, and the many laps of his life in the United States. As before, the film includes research material, much of which has not been viewed publicly before, rare archive material, and special performances from ballet companies and orchestras and soloists from all over the world. During this time, Stravinsky struggled to make a living, saw his work ignored and misunderstood, composed music which many consider incomparable, but is still not widely known, and then became the acknowledged Grand Master, composing to the end in his adopted California. Once again, those who knew and worked with him have been interviewed, and film of Stravinsky himself has been discovered, which enables a surprising amount of this biography to adopt the style of autobiography. Through Robert Kraft, his friend and advisor, we find out his working methods in detail, and his widow, Vera Stravinsky, fills out this television portrait of a man whose life began 100 years ago and ended in 1971, after a career during which, many think, he changed the course of music.